evolution thoughts. Today we are fortunate to have one of the faculty from Department of IMBA BJB Autonomous College. Is a very focused faculty in the HR and management subjects. So I've already mentioned the discipline, what he is going to deliver. So without making any delay, I may request Ms. Tuki Das, who is a faculty from the BJB College, to start her deliberation. Ma'am, now over to you.
Thank you, Srimar, sir. So good morning, all present. Today's topic is wonderfully introduced by Mr. Srimar Paricha. Now, I will be giving you, according to the study material which you have got, my discussion will be confined to that only. And after the class, I will take all the questions you have. So, sir, in between the class, I can take the question or after the session is concluded?
As you wish, but it should be like that. Let the class over. Then I request all the participants to write down their questions in the chat box. And we'll take all those questions after the session is over. So, ma'am, we'll do like that. Okay. So, you continue you go on. Go ahead, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Okay. Now, introducing the topic of management, it is basically if you dissect the word management, you will have management. So, it is like basically when you talk about managing people, the T stands for tactfully. So, managing people tactfully. So, how do the companies, they decide on what to do, when to do, and what not to do, and how to do it, on all these things, the companies need to know what is their course of action, when they will do it, depending on what kind of situation, what they have to, accordingly, they have to perform. So, for all these things, there are certain principles underlying it. So, our discussion will focus on that. Sir, can I have the next slide, please? Okay, so under the unit 1, we will be covering unit 1, 2 and 3 in today's session. Now, under unit 1, as you can see, it is the basics of management is there. Like we will discuss the definitional part of management, then why it is important, then the objective of management, nature of the management, how management is different from administration and all this. Now, if you look at the slide, here it is mentioned that how management is the meaning of management, how it is defined in different ways. Like management as a noun, which refers to the group of manager, whereas the process, it refers to planning, organizing, directing and controlling all these things which are performed in the management arena. The next one is management as a discipline. That means management as a subject. Like how means people who are studying it, they are researching on it, they are evolving with the theories, the application of theories and all those parts. So here management is defined as a discipline. Sir, next slide, please. Now, so here two definitions are given. One is by Henry Fayol, who is known as the father of modern management. Another one is by F.W. Taylor, Frederick Wilson Taylor. So he is considered as the father of scientific management. According to them, what management is. Now, the first definition says that it is to forecast, to plan, to organize, to command, to coordinate, and control the activities of others. Now, here, if you consider the words which are mentioned in this definition, particular definition, to plan, to organize, to command, to coordinate, and to control the activities of others. So others here are the managers, the employees, the top management of the organization. If you consider of all, consider everybody, so that will be others. Now, so to forecast, before you plan, you need to know what you are supposed to do. Then in future, up to what length you are going to plan. So for that reason, you need to forecast. If the situation changes in this way, then what? If the situation changes in that way, then what? So according to the forecast, the plan will be dependent on. Then comes organizing, means planning. After it is done, the work will be divided, key who will be doing what. Then comes command. Here the authority will be there, the subordinates will be there. So they will be directed what they are supposed to do, how and when they are supposed to do. last one is coordinate. Sorry, next is coordinate. So this coordination is among the departments, among the different functional areas, and among the different levels of the management of the organization. And the next one is control. Control is to see whether whatever you have planned, whether you are able to achieve that or not. If you have not achieved it, what is the reason? If you have achieved, how can you improve it? So in that way, it is a cyclical process. Coming to the next definition, which is given by F.W. Taylor. Here again, management is an art of knowing what is to be done and seeing that it is done in the best possible manner. So here, the definition focuses on the process. It emphasizes on the process a lot, that how, what is to be done, as in the planning, what is to be done, it is there. And in the next one, seeing that it is done, so organizing, command, then coordination, all these things will be combined in the how it is to be done. So both the definitions are more or less equal. Only the difference is there in one, the functional aspects are clearly mentioned. In the other, the process is much more emphasized on. Sir, please, next slide. Now, coming to the features of management, the features which are written over here. First one is continuous process. That means, as in the definitional part, we have seen that it starts with forecasting, then goes for plan, then you organize, command, then you go for coordination, and then you go for control. Now, I have also explained that this is a cyclical process. So it is not that one work you have started, the moment it got finished, the work is end there. No. As the organization sustains and it exists in the market, you need to continuously manage things and manage people. So for that reason, it is a continuous process. The next one is pervasive. Pervasive how? Because management is not confined to a single functional area or to a particular level of management. Like we cannot say that it will be only confined to lower level or the top level. It is present everywhere in the organization, regardless of the department, regardless of the level, regardless of the functional area or geographical area or whatsoever, it is present everywhere. Next is result oriented. As again we have seen, or we have discussed in the definitional part, the last step, control. It sees whether the objective which was set in the planning phase, whether that has been achieved or not. So result oriented, obviously whenever we manage something, we want to achieve a result. So the moment we achieve that result, how far we are successful or not, that is seen in the process of management. Next is integrative. Integrative means it integrates all the parts of the organization. So for that reason, it is integrative. Next is multidisciplinary. Now, management is not a pure subject. Rather, it has got its concept from a lot of other disciplines. For example, from economics, from commerce, from engineering, from sociology, anthropology, from psychology, from all these different, even philosophy, from all these different disciplines, management has taken concepts which are applied on our day-to-day function. The next is flexible. Now, the principles which are given by management, they are not rigid. They can be applied as and when required. They can be modified as and when required. So that's why it is flexible. Then comes owners and managers. They may be different. Now, in an organization, whoever is the manager doesn't mean that person has to be the owner. So the owner and the manager, they are. So you can say that the owners are the administrator, whereas the managers are there who manage all those things which are given, the guidelines which are given by the administrator. So owners and managers, they are different. Next is, it's both art and science. Science provides for the principles. Why it is art? Because art is about applying those principles in the process or in the function. So that's why it is both art and science. Next is, management is intangible. Intangibility means which you can't see, which you can't touch, but you can feel it. The presence of management can be felt throughout the organization, day in, day out. So that is why management is intangible. Last one is dynamic. Why dynamic? Because management has to be modified according to the demand of the situation. Now, I am giving example of our current situation. Now, we are all housebound because of this endemic. Now, so organizations have started taking online, means if we consider educational institutions, which have given only physical classroom lecture type, they have modified their teaching style to this online mode. Organizations in which employees they used to go and work from there, now they are working from home for last 2 months. Now you can see as and when the situation demands it, that's how the management has to be done. So that is dynamic. Sir, please the next slide. Now, coming to the importance of management, achieving the objective, that one I already have explained, how management helps in achieving the objective of the organization. Next is optimum utilization of resources. Now, these resources are of different types. We have human resources, we have financial resources, then the market is there, raw material is there, machineries, technologies are there. Now, all these are considered as resources for the organization. Now, so management's response, and also we must keep it in mind that these resources are limited. These are not unlimited resources that you can use it as much as you want. You cannot do that. So for that reason, it is the management's responsibility to utilize these resources optimally to its maximum output. Next is reduces cost. Now, it is related to the point which we right now have discussed, optimum utilization of resources. Now, if resources are used optimally, then it will eventually help the organization to reduce the cost. Next one is establishes a sound organization. All those organizations who have a sound management at place, that means the functions are done properly, the implementations are done properly, those organizations are considered to be healthy organizations. That means whenever the external environment of the organization changes, with the help of a good management at place, the organization can remain competitive in the market. Next is change and growth. Now, all those organizations who are there all those organizations who exist in the market, we know that the external environment has a lot of factors in it, like political environment is there, technological environment is there, economic environment is there. Now, all this environment, they are dynamic, they are not static. Some or other way changes happen in the environment. Now, accordingly, the organization has to be flexible enough. So that is why change. Unless the organization change itself, it won't grow. They need to develop according to the demand of the factors in the external environment. So accordingly, they have to change and then only they will grow. I can give you example of like many companies. Let us take one, Nokia. Nokia was late in adapting to the demand of the external environment, like what the consumers want, how the competitors are behaving. Nokia adapted very late, and because of that, the company has faced such problem. There was a time when the company Nokia was the market leader in India, but again, that has vanished from Indian market for a while because they could not adapt to the demands of the external environment. Now, so change and growth, a proper management, it helps in the organization to change and to adapt and then to grow. Next is provide for innovation. Now, this point is also related to the previous point, change and growth. Now, provide innovation. Now, organization to remain competitive, they need to innovate things. They need to come up with ideas, products which are innovative in the market, which can gain the attraction of the customers. Now, for that reason, the management, it provides for the innovation, like how flexible you can be, how adaptive you can be, and through that innovation can happen. Next is social benefits. Now, social benefits is also a multifold aspect, because in social benefits, again, we can say that through the help of management, we can consider corporate social responsibility, we can consider proper ethical management, we can consider the environment friendly management, like the way company runs, how it is beneficial for the environment, how it is beneficial for the society. So if we consider all of this, then this point, social benefits, is explained. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, coming to the levels of management. So as you can see here, three levels are mentioned: top, middle, and low level of management. If you draw it, it will take a pyramidal shape, because lower level or operative management, in that level, maximum number of employees are there, as it is the entry level position and it is the operative one. So here, the maximum number of employees are there. Then comes, it will taper up as you proceed. The middle management will have the positions like, say, senior manager or manager, then departmental head, all these will be in the middle level management. Coming to the top management, CEO, CFO, chief HR officer, chief operating officer, the board of directors, they will combine the top management. As it is the top management, it has the lowest number of employees or the lowest number of human resources at this level. So all these three levels, they have coordination among each other. Top level formulates the guidelines. It will trickle down to middle level, who will be getting the guidelines and how to do it and everything. Then it will flow down to the lower level operatives, who will be actually doing the work with the help of top and the middle management. So accordingly, all these three levels, even though they are in different levels, the coordination will be there, and the communication also always happens. Sir, the next slide, please. Now, here, the management and administration. So how management is different from administration? The basis which are given are meaning, status, level, and function. Now see, the meaning, as we have discussed, that it is the art of getting things done through others by planning, organizing, directing, communicating, controlling. With all this, it happens. Then comes the administration. Under administration, what happens? Like they formulate the things. So the broad objectives, plans, policies, they will be doing it, and it will be communicated to the management. Next is the status. Now, as you can see, as I have told you, management is different from the owners. Now, so here what happens, that they are paid remuneration. That means in the form of wage and salary, they will be paid. Whereas administration, all those who represent there in the administration, they earn their share only when the capital they have invested, it gets the return on it. From the profit, they will get their earnings. The next one is level. As you can see, under management, it is middle and lower level, whereas administration is comprised of the top level management. Next is functions. Now, management, under management, it is specifically focused on to get the work done, which is like the guidelines which are provided by the top management. Now, under it, you can see it is mainly focused on formulating the plans and policies, which will be later on communicated to the management. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, coming to the applicability, as you can see, it is management function is applicable to the profit-making organization, whereas the administrative one is applicable to both profit-making and non-profit. Like you can see, schools, hospitals are mentioned as examples. So these are non-profit making organizations. The next is process. Now, management decides how to do. Means it is basically focused on the process of it. Whereas the administration is focused on the what is to be done and when it is to be done. What is to be done and when it is to be done means the planning stage. Then it comes down to the management. Next is influence. Now, as you can see, the point is mentioned. The management decisions are influenced by the values, opinions, beliefs, and decision of the manager. Now, it is the responsibility of the manager to make the subordinates achieve it according to the guidelines provided by them. So how they are guiding their subordinates, how they are leading their subordinates, the values, opinion, the decision they take, the values they have, that will be of prime importance. Next is the administrative side. Now, as you can see, the administration is influenced by public opinion, government policy, religious organization, and customs. Every organization is affected by all this. So as the top management looks into the overall general policies, they formulate the plan and everything. So obviously, they will be more influenced by the external environmental factors which in which the organization exists. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, starting with the Unit 2 is focused on scientific management theory. Now, as you can see, F.W. Taylor, which is the photograph, he is the pioneer of it. That is why he is considered as the father of scientific management. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, so Frederick W. Taylor, he was an engineer by profession. So the observation which he had was more focused on the technical aspect of the job rather than the human aspect of the job, like how optimally one work can be done. Means what are the necessary, unnecessary steps which we can eliminate, how we can be concerned about maximum output, and if we increase the remuneration, will that increase the productivity? So his was more of a scientific study of the work process. That is why this theory is known as scientific management theory. It involved a lot of proper steps in a systematic way it was done. Now, as you can see, it is mentioned that in his book, Principles of Scientific Management, he proposed that organization can increase its productivity by doing certain things like optimizing the work, then simplifying the job, then the productivity will increase. So the next slide, please. Now, so here are the definition of scientific management. Obviously, F.W. Taylor has defined it, and Peter Drucker, who is considered to be a pioneer in the management field, he also has defined scientific management. Now, according to F.W. Taylor, what is there? The work can be systematically investigated. The scientific investigation can be there. And from that, we can see that how we can replace the age-old way of doing the work in a more systematic scientific way. So replacing the old way of doing things with the new way of scientific management. The next one is of Peter Drucker. Peter Drucker has said that the core idea of scientific management is that the work is analyzed and it is divided into simple elements. And those elements are the simplified forms of the work. And focusing on that, we can improve productivity. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, so these are the objectives of scientific management. The first one is to achieve higher production and acceleration of the rate of work. Now, so achieve higher production, as I have explained it in the beginning, that the moment we talk about achievement of to achieve higher production, so here what happens is that whenever we work, we need to see how optimally this work can be done. What can be eliminated from it? What can be added to it? Or how else we can do it so that we can achieve the maximum productivity? So the productivity will not be capped. Rather, it will be the workers will be encouraged to perform at their optimum capacity. The next is betterment in the quality of the products by research, quality control, and effective inspection. So now the control mechanism is also emphasized on it. That means only producing more number of units is not enough. The products also need to have their quality assurance. So keeping in check with everything, the speed, the optimum use of utilization of resources, and also the quality aspect of the work. All these will be combined to provide for a better maintenance in quality of the product. The next is decrease in the cost of production. Why it will happen? Because if you systematically analyze the work, you can reduce or eliminate the unnecessary things. The wastage will be reduced, and in that way, it will reduce the cost of production. The next is avoidance of wastage. Like I have told you, the moment we talk about optimum utilization of resources, so here, the moment it is optimally used, obviously, it will give rise to the reduction in wastage, be it time, be it material, be it human effort. In every possible way, the wastage will be reduced. The next one is placement of the right person on the right job through scientific selection and training. That means looking at the skill and capability of the person. The person will be assigned to a job which he or she can perform optimally. Let us say someone doesn't have a particular skill, but he is given the work, then he will not obviously be able to perform that work because he does not possess the skill. Now, let us say typing speed. So if a person doesn't have a good typing speed and he is given the work of a data entry operator, then obviously the person will not perform at the optimal level because he is slow in typing. So this particular theory says that the workers, whenever they are assigned a job, they must be selected scientifically. Means according to their skill and capability, they will be assigned a job. The next one is setting up a sound system of wage payment. Now, this is also a major concern, because if you work and you are not getting paid accordingly, then the motivation will get reduced to work or produce more or to show your productivity. So in this case, and there has to be the differentiation. If I work less, I will be paid less. If someone else is working hard and producing more, then that person will be paid more. So that is the setting of a sound wage payment. The next one is ensuring a regular supply of goods to the consumers at reasonable price. Now, how it will be possible? As we have discussed in the previous points, avoidance of wastage will be there, optimum utilization of resources will be there. The workers will be provided a job, or they will be assigned to a job according to their skill and capability. So obviously this will increase the overall effectiveness of the organization, which will ensure the supply of goods to the consumer on a regular basis. Now, the features of scientific management. First one is systematic approach. Now, obviously, it is a systematic approach because we talk about analyzing, researching, and doing scientific studies. So that's why it is a systematic approach. Next is discard of traditional change. Now, so in this, what happens? Like in the definitional part, we have discussed that scientific management is basically, it talks about discarding the way things are done traditionally. Rather, implementing the scientific approach to the work to generate maximum productivity. Next is improves efficiency of worker. improves efficiency of worker. Why so? Because in this case, what happens that as workers are assigned jobs according to their skill and capability, so they will be motivated to work. And also, depending on the wage which is provided according to the productivity, then also it will help in improving the efficiency. Next is useful for large organizations, because the moment we talk about simplifying the job, standardizing the job, only this can only be possible when there are a lot of things to do and it has a huge employee base. So for that reason, it is useful for large organizations. Next is attempts to minimize wastes. Now, I have already explained this in different aspects of labor time wastages, man hour wastage, time, material. So in all this, we can minimize the wastage. Next is change in attitude. Now, change in attitude in both the groups, like in management and the workers. Now, how it will be beneficial to the workers, how it will be beneficial to the management, how cooperation has to be developed between the workers and the management. So we have to take care of all these things, and that can bring a change in the attitude. Next is give weightage to specializations. Now, as the definition says, that we simplify a specific complex task. So here, when a larger task is or work is divided into simplified tasks, so here the simplified tasks are assigned to specific people. So whoever is doing that task repetitively, they will be specialized in that particular task. Now, coming to the principles of scientific management, first one is science, not rule of thumb. Rule of thumb means whatever principle or guideline is there, that will be applicable everywhere regardless of the differences. So here, it is not rule of thumb. Rather, it is science. That means you understand, you analyze, you collect, gather information, and accordingly, you develop the guidelines, which is suitable to the situation. Next is harmony and not discord. Harmony between the workers and the management means how to cooperate. Next is mental revolution. Now, why it is mental revolution? Because the way things were done before, that has changed. So the mental revolution will be there in all the groups who are involved in the organization. Next is maximum output, not restricted output. Now, it is not that before it was like on a given day you have to do this much because accordingly you pay, you are getting paid a standard wage. But this particular theory talks about a differential wage system. That means whoever is producing more, they will be paid more. Whoever is producing less, they will be paid accordingly. So that's how it can encourage maximum output. Next is cooperation, not individualism. So here, it doesn't talk about alone I can do the things. Rather, it is a coordinated activity. Like I have explained, a complex task is divided among the is divided into simpler tasks. Now, all those people who are assigned into different tasks of that overall work, there the coordination, the cooperation has to be there among them. The next one is development of each and every person for efficiency and prosperity. So, increased productivity, worker gains, increased productivity, the organization also gains. Now, sir, please, the next slide. Okay. Now, coming to the next one here, techniques of scientific management basically talks about these points. Now, functional foremanship. Functional foremanship says, foreman is a supervisor who supervises the work in the subfloor level. Functional foremanship means here also it is divided into different roles. Like whoever is good in which kind of role, accordingly he or she will be given the job of the foreman. The next one is standardization and simplification of the work. Standardization means the way it is done throughout the organization, that particular task will be done in that particular way. So if one worker, let us say, suppose that he or she is absent on a given day, his or her work will not be halted. because it is standardized, so there will be a replacement also. Next is simplification work, which I already have explained. Now coming to work study, sir, can I have the next slide, please? Now you can see the diagram. The work study, under it comes method study, work measurement. So method study will give rise to motion study, work measurement is the time study, and they will be providing the higher productivity. So can we go to the previous one? Now you can see under work study, method, motion, time, and fatigue study are there. Method study means how it is done, means the system of it. Motion study means what is the body motion, how the work is happening. So that is the motion study. Time study, how much time is taken to do that particular work. Fatigue, as human beings are not machines, we tend to get tired after a continuous spell of work. So how much time we need to take rest, and then we can go and work. So combining all this, it will provide for work study. Next is differential piece wage system. Piece wage means per unit how much you are paid. For example, if one unit is produced, then the worker will get 10. So if two, then 20, likewise. So differential piece wage system means a standardized output will be there. Jaise maan lo, per day you have to produce say 10 units. So after 10 units, the moment it goes to 11, the rate will differ. So that way the employees will be motivated to earn more and to produce more. So the next slide, please. The next one, please. Okay. Now, advantages of scientific management. Now, in advantages of scientific management, reduction of cost, obviously it is there. We have discussed all these points, better quality of products, as it is also of a prime concern. Then division of labor, as the work is divided, obviously the different tasks will be divided among different workers. So division of labor is there. Avoidance of dispute, which we have discussed in the coordination between the worker and the management. The next is increased wages in the differential piece wage system. Increased wage system will be there. Then right method of selection and training the worker, as we have discussed already, that properly, scientifically, the workers are selected. The right person will be given the right job. Next is provision for better working environment. As the coordination is there, cooperation is there among the workers, then justified wage system is there. So by all means, it can provide for a better working environment. Last is better utilization of resources. As we have repetitively, we have discussed about optimum utilization of resources. So that summarizes the better utilization of resources without having wastage. So please, the next slide. Now, next is, obviously, no theory is a perfect theory. It will have and everything has a room for improvement. So here also, the scientific management has got some criticisms. So this is divided into two. One is workers' viewpoint, one is employer's viewpoint. From workers' viewpoint, like unemployment, because as you do this, then the machines will be there and machines will replace the workers. So it will increase unemployment. Next is monotony, because works, the tasks are highly standardized. So it will give rise to monotony. Matlab ek kaam ko bar bar karke jo feel aata hai, that is called as monotony. So that will increase monotony. Next is exploitation, because to as differential wage system is there, to earn more, people will work more. And that way, the management can exploit the worker for greater productivity. Next is weakening the trade union. Why so? Because standardized work is there, standardized time limit is there, then the cooperation and coordination will be there. So the trade union will not have much to bargain for. So that's why it will consider to weaken the trade union. Next is overspeeding. To produce more, the means to earn more in differential piece wage, the worker might overspeed the work process. So that is from worker's viewpoint. Coming to the next one, employer's viewpoint, expensive and time consuming. Expensive because it involves a lot of research. So if it involves a lot of research, then analysts will be there, then specialists would be there to gather information, to analyze it, to formulate the policies. That's why it is considered as expensive and time consuming. So please, the next slide. Now that was the end of scientific management. Let us go to the principles of management, which is given by Henry Fayol. Now he is considered to be the father of general management, because in his theory he has concentrated upon the human aspects and the technical aspect of management both. So the next slide, please. Now, so as you can see, what is principle? Principle means a generally or universally acceptable thought or belief. So these are not hard and bound rules, rather these are general guidelines which will guide the way things are done. So the next slide, please. Now you can see characteristics of principles of management. First is universal application. So whatever guidelines are provided, those have universal application. Now depending on like in which industry the organization is, in type of the organization, size of the organization, regardless of that, these principles can be applicable in all types of organizations. General guidelines, so as I have told you, these are not hard and fast rigid rules, regulations, rather these are guidelines which will be implemented according to the ease of the organization. Next is flexibility. So it also has the scope of changing itself, modifying itself according to the need of the situation. Next is behavioral in nature, because these are guidelines for behavior. So that is why it is behavioral in nature. Contingent. Now why it is contingent? Because contingent means depending on something when the other thing changes. Economic environment, something has changed. Technical environment, technological environment, something has changed. So accordingly, how we will be guiding, how we will be changing the guidelines. So that will be contingent upon the factors in the environment. Next is equal importance, means all those 14 principles which are provided under this particular theory, all those principles are equally important. We cannot say unity of command is much more important than unity of direction. No, all the 14 principles have equal importance, equal weightage, as all of them are important for the organization. Next is cause and effect relationship. This says that if this happens, then what? If this is the cause, what will be the effect? If we apply this, what will be the result? So that is cause and effect. Next is need of principles of management, why it is needed. Management principles, first is smooth and effective control of the organization. If the general guidelines are there, then it will be easy for us to manage the organization. Helps in jurisdiction of work, as division of labor is one of the principles. So obviously it will say who will be doing what work and when it will be done, how it will be done. So that jurisdiction of work will be there. Next is management principles help in simplifying management practices. So as the principles are there, as the guidelines are there, it will help the management to implement those guidelines into the practices. Next is it helps in formulating a plan of action. Division of labor, say for example, if division of labor is there, then how the work will be divided, who will be doing what, when that will be finished. So plan of action can be formulated. Next is managers don't have to use trial and error method. As the guidelines are there, accordingly you have to work, accordingly you have to perform devise the process of the work. So here there is no question of trial and error. Ye kaam karta hai ki nahi dekhte hain, wo kaam karta hai ki nahi dekhte hain. So we are not concerned with that, as the guidelines are clearly provided, accordingly we will be doing the work. Next is, it sets working rules of managerial functions, like planning, organizing, directing, controlling, or for all of this, the principles will be provided as the basic guidelines. Then obviously to improve productivity, because whatever the organization does, that is done to improve the productivity, which is the ultimate goal of the organization to achieve. The next slide, please. Now, Henri Fayol, who is a French industrialist, he has studied the organization and then he has conceptualized these 14 principles. These 14 principles in the first book, he has written it in French. Then it got translated into English, which is General and Industrial Management, got published in 1949, in which all the 14 principles are mentioned. Now, he was the first person who has identified planning, organizing, directing, and controlling. Okay, instead of directing, he has used the word commanding. So planning, organizing, commanding, and controlling. He was the first ever researcher to come up with these basic functions of the management. So next slide, please. Now, these are the 14 principles of management by Henri Fayol. Coming to the first one, division of work. Division of work, one person cannot do everything. And one person cannot possess the skill and capability to do the entire work. For that reason, we require division of labor. So here, the work will be divided into small tasks, and those tasks will be divided among workers who possess the skill and capability to perform that one. Next is authority and responsibility. Each task will have some authority and responsibility attached with it, regardless of the level in which it is performed. That means if I am assigned a particular work, I will have the authority to decide how to do it, the ways of doing it. Then the ultimate result will also be my responsibility. So authority and responsibility. Next is discipline. Discipline means in the organization, how the task will be divided, then who will be performing it, then how the coordination will be there, what is the way in which the communication will happen for and how I am supposed to behave. All these things will be under discipline. Next is unity of command. Unity of command says that if I am a subordinate, I should only have one manager or one supervisor. If I get instructions from multiple supervisors, then I will get confused and my productivity will be reduced. So unity of command says that if one person has one boss, then the clarity of instruction will be there. Next is unity of direction. Unity of direction means in what way the direction flows. Means all those commands which are provided, the directives which are provided, what is the direction of it? Like top to down, bottom to top, diagonal. So for every way, every flow of communication, we need to have a direction. Next is subordination of individual interest. Subordination of individual interest means the individual interest. Like if I am part of an organization, I am there to earn. I am there to earn money for myself and my family. So my individual objectives will be there to gain experience, to gain skill, and all, to earn more. So my individual objectives will be there. But how that will be beneficial for the organization? That will only be beneficial for the organization if my objectives are aligned with the organizational objectives. So in this way, what will happen? If I achieve my objective, I will be contributing towards the overall achievement of the organizational objective. That is subordination of individual interest. Next is remuneration. It talks about the salaries and wages according to the level of skill, the capability, the productivity of the worker. The remuneration has to be an equitable one. Next is degree of centralization. Means how the work is controlled, whether all the decisions are taken by the manager or the employees are also allowed to participate in it. So centralization and decentralization, depending on the nature of the work, then the organization can decide that up to what level it will be centralized and up to what level the decentralization will be allowed. Now, scalar chain principle talks about the communication, means how the communication will flow inside the organization. Means if certain things needs to be communicated to the workers, then how it will be communicated to them. Also, the concept of gangplank is there in scalar chain principle. That means when it is required that you have to bypass the flow of communication chain. Ki manlo, you need to communicate something to the workers and that has to go through 5 levels. Now, if you do not have the time, because the work is urgent, you do not have time to go through these 5 levels of communication channel, you can bypass 2 or 3. That is called as the gangplank communication. Next is order. Order means everything. Department, how it is divided, the structure of the organization, the work which is assigned, the functional units of the organization, how properly each and every one coordinate with each other. That is order. Next is equity. Now, equity is about the justifiable remuneration, then the treatment which is given to the employees, all these will be under equity. Next is stability of tenure. Stability of tenure means if I am an employee of the organization, whether my job is secure or not. If I get this feel that my job is not secure, any moment they can throw me out of the organization, then I will not be motivated or I will not be productive. But only when I get this idea that when I work, my work will be according, means my work will be praised and my work will be considered by the organization, my contribution will be considered by the organization, then only the worker will be a stable one. Now, so stability of tenure is also important. If the job, like the layoff happens more and more often than usual, then the workers will not be productive. But if the stability is there in the organization, the workers will also be with a sound mind and they will be working. Next one is initiative. How the workers are taking, means employees, are taking initiative to do something new, to bring creativity, innovativeness, so starting something or showing leadership quality, that is initiative. Last one is Esprit de Corps. Esprit de Corps, this principle says, united we stand, divided we fall. Corona wala situation nahi hai, because right now for us it is divided we stand, united we fall. But for the organizational principle, it is united we stand, divided we fall. Here we need to be united regardless of the functional areas, geographical areas, levels of management. Everybody has to be with everybody, then only the organization will flourish, it will grow, and it will be effective and achieve its overall organizational objectives. Next slide, please. So here we are at the end of the session. Unit 1, 2, 3, all are covered. Sir, if there is any question, I will take it.
Thank you, madam. I would like to request two learners are there, Anubhav and another is Suman. So I request both of you, if you want to ask any question, then you unmute your mic and you ask question directly to our resource person. Otherwise, you write down your question in the chat box and that question will be answered by our resource person. Even I request all other participants, they can ask questions if they have. so that it can be answered by our resource person. What I assume, I think there are no questions. Please, it should be acknowledged by Suman and Anubhav. If there is no questions, please write no. If yes, then write some questions.
So can we end the session?
Yes. So, ma'am, at the last, I would like to thank you for a wonderful session you had.
Thank you, sir.
At the same time, I would like to thank my colleague Rudra Pratap Das, who is giving the technical support for this session. At the same time, I would like to thank my colleague Sushri Sangeeta Saraf, who was there throughout the session. So it was a nice session all together. And I'd like to thank both the learners who had joined. And thank you so much. One message came, okay, that is again from Rudra. So now we come to the end of this session. Next time we'll have some different topic. At the same time, I would like to thank our resource person, Mr. Thank you, sir. So please disengage this platform, and
thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Okay, you just leave the platform. Disengage now. Yeah, thank you so much.